Next, in the component view, we are going to add the Readme script to a component. The Readme script is commonly used as the component's home page, sort of. So if you were to go to GitHub, for example, let's open GitHub. We are on the demo components page on GitHub, and you'll see that it has this nice image here, and it has some details and some layout. Now this all is done with the readme file, so it's with this file here. We can open that and then look at the raw, and here you can see it's basically the same text as we were looking at previously. So inside of component builder you can add this readme text, and this is basically placeholders. Now I know that that is part of the markup for a header, so you need to know a little bit about markdown to know what is placeholders and what is not. That is why I added this script, so you can sort of get an idea of everything that are placeholders, and these placeholders are automatically updated from the details that are in these fields here. So you can see the actual placeholders names. It's nice. So if you change the version here, it'll update it there automatically. So that is just the readme file, really a place for you to give a lot of information to those who are using your application. So they, maybe you can add some links to it, or you could have some links to help menus, or even instructions on installing it, or anything else that you'd like to share through the readme file. I would ask, if it's not too much for you, for you to leave this area, this commenting. The more people using Component Builder, the more involvement in the community, others getting this training set, help us to sustain this project. So if you leave that in, it will certainly be helpful. You're not compulsory, I mean, it's only if you want to. And then if you want to know more about markdown, then you can open this link here, and it shows you a little bit of a cheat sheet of everything that you can do. Okay, so that is looking at the readme area. This admin view area and the site view area should be seen as a place where you can create new admin views. Do realize that if you create a new admin view, it's not necessarily linked to this component. You need to still link it in here in settings under admin view. This is more a place to create admin views, so you can click on new, or to edit existing admin views that are linked to this component. Same goes with the site views. So it's simply a way for you to gain access to editing those site views that are already linked to this application easily. And then the fourth, we want to look at is the FTP server. Now the FTP server has basically been added to give you a hand in moving this application, this component, to your server, and also add the feature of that automated updating that is inside of Joomla. So the update server is actually a Joomla concept, and if you open a component, so I'll open Simon Distributor. Front, I need to look at the back end. And we look at the XML file of this component. Component Builder obviously builds this whole file for you. But at the very bottom, you see that there is a app update server that is being added. Now, this is not added if you have not set this. So if this was set to no, it will not be adding an update server. If you add this, then you can set the link to where the update server is, you know, going to be hosted, and it will automatically take that link and add it into your XML file like it's done here. And that file itself, Component Builder can also build that file for you. The way it does it is that this obviously should look like that. Host equals host name, and port equals port int and an integer, and an option bracket type equals FTP binary. Now this FTP binary usually is 15. That is the default value, FTP binary, whereas that would usually be 21 and that would usually be 15. Then a username and a password. Now this FTP details should actually log in directly to this folder that you have up here, this updates folder. Okay, that one. So that basically all Component Builder does is it logs into your server, moves this file in there, and then this disconnects. And this information is what will make it possible for him to do that. The same goes with the sales server. The sales server usually would be very much the same concept. You'd simply be adding the same kind of string here, except usually the update server and the sales server is not the same place. The update server lets the user know that there is an update, whereas the sales server is actually where this component's zip file will be stored on your server. So if you have something like WHMCS or another component through which you are selling your extensions, you can use the folder on your server which it's looking for the files. You can use that folder, you know, create an FTP account to that folder and then set that details in this field here, and then Component Builder, on the moment that you click compile, it has an option here. It says add backup folder and save sales server. You click that to yes, and if you compile it now, it will move the zip file to your sales server as well as creating a backup. Now the backup and the git folder is actually set up in your components global options. So we haven't really spoken much about the global options. Let us open it now here. We saw in this area here that it says that this field is encrypted. Now in Component Builder, if you go to global settings, it says encryption settings, and in here you would add your own key by which it will encrypt. Once you've added this key, you shouldn't change it because it will obviously not be able to decrypt, because it's used to encrypt and as well to decrypt the data. So if you, well, that just means everything that's been encrypted is now needs to be redone, which in this case is going to be these login information, this FTP login information. This is the basic encryption that we spoke of when we talked about storing types. You got basic encryption, advanced encryption. Now this is the basic encryption way, basically having such a, it's also called a basic key. Then you have files here, or folder paths. These two first folder paths, called compiler folder and custom folder, I would leave them for now. They're a little buggy. I haven't fully managed to achieve them being flexible. So to move them at this stage is difficult for a number of reasons. For now, I would suggest you just leave them blank. But here you would add a backup folder, and this obviously should be related to the root of your server. So as well as a git folder. And the git folder would be where Component Builder creates a folder with all the components files without zipping them. And then you can go to that folder and create a git, you know, git init, create a git repository there, and from that folder you can push to GitHub or any other Git server respectively. So basically it's able to create a folder from which you can do GitHub or any other kind of repository work, which are separate from your backup folder, and also separate from the temporary folder in which it compiles the component. So you can move it out of your Joomla install basically. And that's what these folder paths are for. So when you do the compiling of the component, it does that Git repository. It won't delete the .git folder. It will just replace all the files in it. Basically first remove the old ones, then add the new ones, and Git obviously will see that only the files that has been changed it will notice, and those who you need to do a recommit, or just an obviously a normal commit, to get it into your repository. Obviously if you don't know Git, then possibly this doesn't make sense to you. There's some great courses as well about Git on lynda.com as well as Udemy, so you can just go look in at those. Okay, so that's the backup folder, and the sales server, the same goes here. This FTP credentials should be the direct folder in which these zip files should be stored. Unfortunately, Component Builder cannot store it in subfolders at this point. So the FTP details, he will just log into that FTP account, and in that very folder which he has the access to, he'll put the file there. So no subfolders or other folders. The FTP details should be going directly to the folder. Now in the Component Builder, I was thinking, just for your own peace of mind, if you look in Component Builder, so that will be in the backend, components, Component Builder, and then helpers, there's a file called compiler. If you open that file, you would see that we have a function here, build.me, and here is all the placeholders that you can use in the build.me file, and it will be replaced with the relative information. And then there is a function here called move file to FTP server, and this move file to FTP server calls another function called get FTP. Now get FTP is this function here, and basically it takes the signature, checks whether we already made such a connection before, and then loads that object. But here basically I'm using this parse string function to convert the string into variables. So all the variables in that string is converted to arrays or variables respectively, and that then is used to actually make use of Joomla's own client FTP class. So if you want to know where that is, you can in NetBeans you click control spacebar, and it shows you it's in library Joomla clients ftp.php. That's where the file is. If you click there, it'll open it. So we're basically using Joomla's built-in FTP client, and we're passing the host, the port, the options, the username and the password, and making a connection, and then we're sending that off to this move file, which then basically takes the file content and moves it to the server. So that's just for your own peace of mind, that the data itself is not being leaked or compromised. It's all handled right here, and you can follow its events in Component Builder from relations to the update server as well as to the sales server. The other thing that I know is quite important is this update server is an XML file, and this XML file is basically built up of versions and download links to those versions. So like I explained to you in a previous video, there is this reality that while you're developing your component, your users, wouldn't need any change updates or anything like that. But the moment you put your component out there in the web, immediately you need to consider when you make a change in the application. how will your user be able to adapt to that change? And the biggest changes you can make is adding new views or adding new fields to the component. And so that makes it a little hard, but like I explained previously with the history component, we've done scripting to take control of that problem. But you also need to think about the database. And so we created this thing called version updates, which gives you the ability to actually add SQL scripting, which needs to be executed upon the updating. Now, the way for you to think about this, if you have a new version, let's say 1.2.9, then, and now you know that there needs to be a table alteration. Obviously, you need to know MySQL commands to do that. I'm not going to teach you that. You just need to put that MySQL command in here, according to the Joomla conventions, which means the table name must have that hash underscore underscore in front of it, and Joomla will dynamically put in the prefix. So you just simply will do a MySQL script here. But if you are making a change and the new release is 1.2.9 and 1.0 didn't have that specific field or view, then you must realize that you're updating this one, and so the SQL must come next to that specific version. The update must be placed at the version which needs the update. So that if you make a change, don't put it here because it won't update correctly. You need to put the update next to the version that needs to be updated. And then over here, you would put the link to the respective downloads. Okay, so like here we had version 2.9 and then we had version 1.3.0 and we added the 1.3.0 link here. Now obviously I'm using GitHub as my distributing platform of the application. You could use any URL, and these URLs is what will be used in your update server. So the update server, if I was to open that for us, first let me close this. We'll go to the update server link, copy that. You'd see that it has this URLs here for the download. And as we move on, it's 3, 3.1, 3.2. And so it's getting these details. It is getting them from this version update area. And so the last version in this list, being 1.3.2, must be the same as the one that you set here. That is important, so that it will know, okay, now we are at the current version, and it will do the necessary adjustments to that. Okay, so that is basically all the concepts that would be necessary to cover regarding the component area. We've looked at adding admin views. We will again look at site views and adding them, as well as your custom admin views. And we will possibly go into more depth about this MySQL tweak that we briefly spoke about. But for the most part, that's your component area and all its nice features. Obviously, it all stacks upon each other, from the fields, then the admin views, and then the components themselves. And if you have come this far, you've set out your component, you've added some admin views, you're now ready to start building the front and the site area, which you wouldn't be able to really do effectively until now. It is really necessary to first do the admin views and then only do the site views. Well, thank you for watching.